Welcome to this special session on economictimes.com. I'm your host, Pallavi. In this session, we're going to focus mainly on debt funds, how you can generate capital from there and also achieve your goal in short term. I'm happy to be joined by Mr. Vaibhav Shah, Head Product and Marketing, Mirae Asset Investment Managers India Private Limited, a result-oriented professional with over 15 years of experience in financial services and stock market. He's responsible for product, marketing, and corporate communications for Mirae Asset Investment Managers India Private Limited. I'm also being joined by Colonel Retired Sanjeev Govila, founder Hum4G Financial Services Private Limited. Mr. Govila categorically has a clientele of only army officials. He has keen interest in investments, and after retiring from armed forces, he has forayed into investment business. He's been a pioneer in promoting SIP in depth. I welcome both of you to this panel.
Thank you, Pallavi.
So to begin with, as we say, SIP is not a new concept, but when we say SIP in debt, this may seem alien to some of us. So maybe I can start with Vaibhav first. Vaibhav, as we know, SIP, thankfully, with all the campaigns over the years by AMFI, this has become quite a household word. At least everybody knows what SIP is. But talking about SIP in debt, is it any different from SIP in equity? And basically, does it work any differently? How would you explain that?
So thanks, Pallavi, for having me for this session. And you rightly pointed out, it becomes such a common name in household that if you were to ask anyone, do you do mutual funds? You say, no, I don't invest in mutual funds, but I do an SIP.
Right.
So SIP has become that synonymous way of investing. Now, when it comes to investing, I think so one of the biggest thing of investing is to be disciplined. And what SIP brings is discipline of investing. Here, I want to bring an analogy to explain why SIP in debt is not different from SIP in equity. And I would like to take an analogy from cricket, which is, a sport all of us follow, love. When you bat, you need a lot of patience, a lot of discipline to create a long innings. But if you're a bowler, you need to have a lot of patience, going to the right length and length to take wickets. I'm saying same if you were to look at, batting maybe as an equity, which is more attractive. But, debt, sort of I can make it as bowling, which is very disciplined. So if you want to invest in debt also, you have to be very, very disciplined. And SIP is one of the most beautiful ways of investing in debt as well. And whatever benefits of SIP that we've been hearing from all our, communications, right from AMFI, from every fund houses, from advisors who've spread this across the entire, set of investors, all those benefits of rupee cost averaging, taking advantage of market volatility, continue for debt investments as well. And, I'm very fortunate to have Sanjeev here with me in today's session. And like you pointed out, Sanjeev is someone who's worked in the armed forces. Armed forces are one of the most disciplined set of people that you would, associate with. So I'm sure I would also want to hear what Sanjeev has his perspective. And he's been a great advocator of SIP in debt. But from an AMC perspective, we really believe that time has come that people embrace SIP in debt as well as they have accepted SIP in equity.
Sure. So, Mr. Sanjeev, do you think it's more because of lack of awareness that, SIP in debt still remains a lesser known concept? What are your thoughts?
Beautifully said, Vaibhav, especially the analogy was great. It is actually lack of awareness, like Pallavi, you said. Mm-hmm. Maybe somewhere we've not talked about SIP in debt merely because most of the advisors themselves have not thought of SIP in debt. That I feel is a big reason. There are three primary reasons why somebody should do SIP in debt. Very first one is for most of the people who are employed, the money comes in tranches every month. So it makes sense to invest in tranches, whatever tranche be, whether it is 1,000 rupees or 1 lakh rupees or whatever. Second thing is, we Indians have a very big mindset of investing through bank, and a large number of people do RDs, recurring deposits. SIP in debt is an equivalent of recurring deposit. And that is the best way you can explain to somebody why SIP in debt, because when that person Googles, he also comes across a word that there is, you know, because market volatility is there, hence you should do SIP, which is not really relevant in debt funds. And third thing is, the way we explain to people is, tiny droplets make the mighty ocean. So just keep putting your droplets, don't look at it in the short term, and you will have the ocean ready for you when your requirements come. So I said it from the advisor's perspective.
Sure. In fact, Vaibhav, we're also addressing the common misconceptions that people have around, debt funds. So from your position, from your perspective, what do you find as the most common misconception regarding debt funds?
So I think so. One thing that, investors need to understand is, when you invest in debt, like you have equity market, which goes through its own cycles. In the case of debt markets, also you have the debt market being impacted by the interest rates and the RBI actions. So there will be some amount of volatility in debt markets, which investors need to understand. Now, when it comes to debt investing, primarily there, I would say two main risks. One is duration risk and one is the credit risk. Duration risk, I think so investors can navigate when they increase their time horizon. So like we always say in equities, you should have a time horizon, say 3 years, 5 years and above. The reason we say that is because the moment he increases the time frame, the probability of him losing money becomes lower. So when it comes to debt investing also, even if you get your interest rate view wrong, right? And let me give an example that in the last 5 years, the RBI rate or the 10-year G-Sec was 8.5 and fell down to as low as 5.8. So it may seem that 2.5-3% actually is a lot of change in interest rate for normal individual investors. And we are at some point we saw home loans and other loans being at lifetime lows. Right. So when interest rates go down so much, you have to make sure that even if you get your interest rate call wrong, which is you enter say maybe at the top or the bottom, if you increase your time frame, you can get a better experience. And that's true for any market. Mm-hmm. Second is credit risk. And I think so here is where the real education is required, is when you come to debt, and a lot of people say debt means fixed income. Mm-hmm. But income, it is not fixed, because it's, mutual funds will always carry the disclaimer that mutual funds are subject to market risk.
Right.
And past performance is no indication of future. So when you invest in debt, you have to be very sure you invest in very good quality debt instruments. So credit is a very, very important thing that we think all investors should definitely know. Don't go for funds where the credit is higher, or the one more thing, Pallavi, I wanted to add, a lot of advisors and investors ask this question very common to us, and is they say that we look at YTM or yield to maturity in debt, and we equate it as, what bank FD gives is what mutual funds can give when we look at YTM. Mm-hmm. And we reduce the expenses. We've seen time and again that the YTM and the fund returns have got no correlation. There have been times, I want to highlight, say last year, where funds YTM were maybe 7%, but the fund returns were double digit, 10%. Because when the interest rate fell down, you could get some appreciation. So YTM is again one misconception which is there. So a lot of investors, when they look at YTM, they don't look at the credit. Mm-hmm. You can get a higher yield if you go lower to the credit. So I think so investors and partners need to look at credit very, very closely. Mm-hmm. They need to remove funds and instruments which have lower credit. And that's why yields can look higher, but the experience can be badder. Or investors. So these are some misconceptions, I think so, people need to be really aware of.
Sure. In fact, Sanjeev sir, as you mentioned, just a while ago, that they're essentially put against bank fixed deposits and recurring deposits, and these are all essentially short-term instruments. So in your opinion, if somebody has some short-term goals, would this be an alternative, a better alternative in terms of better returns And also, if you could highlight the different categories in debt funds, because, you know, as we know, the awareness levels are still very low, and we would like to explore more about debt funds. But could you take us through what debt funds are all about and how do they really work?
Yeah, absolutely, Pallavi. Before that, I would say that we need to understand the mindset of the people who agree to invest in debt funds. You know, I'm deliberately using the word agree to, because when you say mutual fund to a common man, even somebody who's been investing for years, is stock market. So mutual fund, stock market, it will go down. Oh, market is going down. So what is happening to my funds? Even though that guy might be 90% in debt funds. So the question that gets asked is, I don't know, what do you mean by debt funds? If they are safe, why don't they give interest? If they give interest, why don't you tell what interest will they give? You know, things like these come up. If they are safe, then why do some people say that some debt funds are riskier than other debt funds? You know, these kind of things are not very easy to understand. And I'm investing for the long term. Why are you giving me this fund which has the category of ultra short term fund or low duration fund? I've told you I need the money after 5 years. You know, these are the kind of myths which you have to explain to the client before you really take him or her to debt funds. So while giving this out, I have given out certain, you know, categories. Now the categories do not merely depend on what is the duration of the goal. You can invest today in an ultra short term fund for a goal which is coming up 5 years later only because the risk scenario, the interest rate scenario demands so today. If you say, okay, five year goal is there, and I put that in a fund which has a 5 year duration, then things will go drastically wrong and the client will have a short term bad experience. You know, every client who comes to you is necessarily a long term client, but the moment something happens, then that guy is a short term trader. That is what, you know, we experience every day. Now coming down to whether you can meet the financial goals using debt. Definitely you can do that. But of course, one has to see what is the risk profile. If the risk profile matches, and if the risk profile says that this person has to have high amount of safety, then you have no way but to go with debt funds. And I would say when you go in for debt funds, then it is better to see today's interest rate scenario and then give the debt fund. For example, like I said earlier, even for a 5 year duration goal, you have to give a very short term debt fund right now. You cannot afford to give a long term debt fund. Or alternately, you could take the client to either corporate bond fund, wherein the duration matches the person's goal, or a dynamic bond fund. So dynamic bond fund, if they don't really are into taking too much of risk, then and they play it pretty safe and they have a record of doing that, then you can easily take the client to a dynamic bond fund, because a 5 year goal could may necessarily not be 5 year only, it could be 4 years or it could be 5, 6, 7 years also.
Right.
So this is the way you manage depending on the client's behavior that you anticipate, current environment, interest rate environment, and also, one thing I forgot to mention, what kind of investment does the person already have?
Okay. Sure.
Yeah. That's.
So, Vaibhav, coming back to you, we're talking about the different categories, but as we can understand, debt funds are essentially, you know, they are categorized as per their duration. So, how would you suggest if one has to match their goal tenure with their investment horizon? What's your take?
So Pallavi, you know, like Sanjeev mentioned, I think so very, very important that first, you know, you should know your risk appetite. And that's very clearly one of the first starting pillars for deciding where to invest. So like Sanjeev said, if you even have a 5 year time horizon, but you are very, very conservative, then even in debt, you wouldn't choose certain categories where the risk component will be higher, because you wouldn't want to take that much risk in your portfolio. So first step would be to know your own risk profile. And that's where, you know, advisors really help investors in assessing the risk. Second, Second is, you know, I would say you should go for categories where, you know, SEBI has helped the industry a lot by clearly defining what is a category, what is the credit you can have that in that category, what is the minimum duration of paper that, you know, the fund house or the fund can hold. And then the investor, you know, can base some of these buckets, can make a easier choice, of course, with the help of an advisor. So, for example, like Sanjeev mentioned, someone has, you know, 3 to 5 year time horizon and wants to achieve, you know, short term goals. You know, there are beautiful categories like banking, PSU funds, debt funds, corporate debt funds, bond funds. These are beautiful categories where, you know, you are investing in AAA good quality instruments. So you do not worry about the portfolio. Your time horizon is 3 to 5 years, which means you get the benefit of interest rate cycle movements. And on top of it, if you can do an SIP in debt, and you know, Sanjeev brought a very brilliant point that we get money, most of us get money in tranches. So why not invest in tranches? Okay. So that's where if you start investing in tranches, then, you know, beautifully you can invest in these categories with a 3 to 5 year time horizon.
Sure.
There are many categories I want to tell you, Pallavi, that a lot of people have this misconception that debt cannot beat equity in the long term. But it would have been a surprise that from 2010 to 2020, if you had taken that period, debt had actually outperformed equity. So many of the gilt funds had outperformed equity funds during that period. So, you know, when your time horizon is long, and I think so, we are in a place where structurally interest rates in India should move down. We've already seen interest rates move from, say, 12% to 10%, 8%, 6%. Yet, when you see the world, you know, 35% of the world at negative interest rate, 35%, 70% of the world at less than 1.5% interest rate, India at 6% interest rate is still a very, very attractive investment destination. And I'm saying in the next decade, you would definitely see interest rates being much lower than where we are. And so investors who have a long-term time horizon can look at big categories like long duration gilts. And you would be also surprised that some of these funds can deliver you double-digit returns as well. So a lot of factors, risk profile, time horizon, has to be considered by investors.
Sure. In fact, Sanjeev sir, as we are, you know, understanding the different categories and how they help, could you also tell us of investing in debt funds? Is it only SIP or there might be other route also through which a person can put in money in debt?
One very simple, straightforward thing is bulk amount. Mm-hmm. I mean, you don't have to worry about investing in bulk the way one worries in equity, especially if the equity markets are fluctuating. Mm-hmm. Then obviously it is not advocated that you put a bulk in equity market. Mm-hmm. But debt, you are going in for safety. There is no way. I mean, there is no compulsion on one to, you know, try and do STP or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So bulk, SIP, there are the very interesting mindset that, you know, a few of our clients, when the markets have gone up, they said, okay, whatever gains I'm making in my equity fund, those gains can be periodically sent to the debt funds and, you know, you can secure them. So we tried reasoning that we are not really securing, you're just taking out a part of those equity mutual funds. But then if Pallavi, you ask me, that is one new way which I have discovered you can do. Mm-hmm. So these are the ways. There's nothing else that I can think of. One more thing, especially the retired people.
Right.
You know, lots of retired people, I would say almost every retired person goes in for two avenues. One is Senior Citizen Savings Scheme, SCSS, right. And second is POMIS. Post office monthly income scheme.
Mm-hmm.
That is where the interest from that, it comes to their bank, gets merged with you know, rest of the money, and nobody knows where that money went. And after 5 years or so, they just get back their time value of money depreciated, you know, principal back. So we tell them to use this money as the SIP, as per the frequency that it is coming to them, to put the money in as debt asset.
Sure. And just to add to this question, since we're discussing SIPs, there are routes like STPs, you also mentioned that, and SWPs. So in terms of the returns, do they work any differently? I mean, what is your opinion, Sanjeev?
No, STP, I don't advocate STP in debt funds at all. I mean, it has no meaning unless we are seeing that there is interest rate is going to move in such a manner that it will be better if you defer your investments. Okay. So that is one way which we could think of. Otherwise, STP is not something which is meant for debt funds. And when we talk about SWP, SWP is something we advocate very, very strongly all the time.
Okay.
Systematic withdrawal plan is the best way to take pension, and there is just no doubt about it at all. So people who try to take their pension through NPS, through insurance plans, through so many other avenues, through FDs, corporate FDs, bank FDs, we very, very actively show them, see, this is what you are missing out. If you do SWP, you could be paying just about 1/5 or even sometimes 1/6 of the tax that you're paying there. Here you have the entire, flexibility. You can build up your corpus whichever way you want. In SWP, you can choose a frequency that you want, the amount that you want. You can increase it, decrease it, stop it, restart it. Whatever you wish to do, you can do it. So SWP is, I think, the most powerful way to have a pension.
Right. In fact, Vaibhav, as we are, understanding and discussing about, how with the little tweaks in our strategy, maybe we can really make debt funds work for us. But in your opinion, when it comes to long-term goals, you were earlier talking about how they have the potential to, beat even equity. So in your opinion, do you think can debt funds be used for long-term goals as well?
So I think one of the most important things, Pallavi, is time and again, any advisor or asset management company will tell you asset allocation. And if you are over allocated to any asset class, be it equity or debt, you're doing, harm to yourself. You need to have the appropriate amount of equity, debt, gold, real estate as a part of your asset allocation. So first and foremost important thing is asset allocation. So within that asset allocation, if you get your debt component planned for the long term, it is definitely works a lot in your favor. But you need to create first your asset allocation, your financial plan, and then bifurcate X amount to equities, X amount to debt.
Right.
I only want to highlight that in long term, equities have definitely showed the potential to outperform inflation, and equity has outperformed, inflation and debt. But there are cycles where debt has equally done very, very well. So you cannot have only equity if your time horizon is 10. So let me give another example, Pallavi. If someone is, say, 25, 30 year old, and he says, I have 30 years to retirement, let me have 100% of my money to equity. Because his time horizon is so large, still we wouldn't say you should have 100% of your money to equity, because you're taking significant risk in your portfolio. You need to have the asset allocation right and have certain part in debt, even from the long-term perspective. And that's very, very critical that investors do follow that discipline while creating the portfolio strategy. So one thing I wanted to again just add, Pallavi, in this scenario where we've seen in the last 1 year, in March, market was 26,000 and now is currently at 52,000 on the Sensex. Equity markets has shown 100% return in last 1 year. And when you see debt yields at 4% or 5%, a lot of investors and advisors are questioning, why should I look at debt when equity has outperformed so well? And they should just reflect what happened in March 2020, where in just 15 days, market fell down 40%.
Right.
So the debt cushions your overall portfolio. It creates better risk-adjusted performances. And that's, and Sanjeev sir rightly pointed out, one key benefit of debt versus traditional fixed income instruments is the indexation benefit when you hold for 3 years. When you consider that for the long-term investing, debt also is a equally good instrument that investors should look at.
Mm-hmm. Sure. So any ideal portfolio won't be 100% debt or 100% equity. It has to be a good mix. So Sanjeev sir, if you could help us understand when one has to do the asset allocation, how does one decide how much of it has to be kept in equity and how much of it has to be kept in debt and other instruments, gold and other areas where Vaibhav also highlighted? What's your opinion?
Okay. Pallavi, you see, Vaibhav has brought out a very, very important point, that is asset allocation. Everybody talks about asset allocation. And when the time comes, investor is the very, very first one to junk it. And after some time, with investor's pressure, the financial advisor is the second one to junk it. So it is very, very difficult to really adopt asset allocation as a stable way of investing. Second thing before I answer your question is that everybody talks about behavior. I have realized after such a long time that ultimately investing is in the head. Everything is here. It is not in the percentages. It is not in the returns. There is a beautiful book, Psychology of Money by Morgan Housel. And there are plenty of other books also. They talk more about how to understand what is going on in the head of the investor and in future also likely to go in various situations rather than where to get more returns from. Finally, if the person is not comfortable, all ideas of investing in this class or that class will go out of the window.
Right.
Now, based on this, that ultimately the person has to be very comfortable with what is being invested where, I would say that it is extremely important that risk profile be done before anything else is done. Hmm. So to say that a long-term portfolio should have 70% equity, 30% debt, and some gold and some real estate, I think fundamentally that would be wrong. Hmm. There are people who are very comfortable with 80% debt and 10% gold and 10% equity for years and years, because they don't see fluctuation. And since if they don't take it out, they don't see taxation being deducted, they're very happy with it. Mm-hmm. And on the other hand, there are some very, very, trigger happy people who would never be, if the market is going up and their portfolio is not going up accordingly, even though their risk profile said something else, then they would become very, very uncomfortable and probably, decide to shift out. So I would say number one thing is to do the risk profiling. Number two is for the investor to understand that there is something called asset allocation, and there are lots of heat maps which are going around. They are available all on the net to look at how different things have performed at different times.
Right.
Once that is understood, and the person is comfortable with this idea of investing, then a portfolio should be made. Coming to very, very broad thumb rule, which does not take into account both the things that I've talked just now. For long-term goals, one should start with 50-50 portfolio.
Okay.
And then depending on how comfortable the person is or uncomfortable the person is, you should tweak it up or down. Hmm. The rule of 72, etc., all those rules are there. They are actually practical rules.
Right.
Those kind of rules should be applied to people. I'll give you an example. Somebody who's fully retired.
Mm-hmm.
Now, whether that person gets 2% more returns or less returns doesn't really matter as long as they don't see much of fluctuation. While a very young person, that person is amenable to taking risks, mm-hmm, and going into very high equity.
Yes.
So, a stable answer cannot be given to this. It has, mm-hmm, to be absolutely customized to the person.
Correct. Yeah. Sure. So as we also understand that personal finance is very personal, I mean, it would depend on the individual, what kind of risk profiling, as you mentioned, and what kind of goals he has or she has. So Vaibhav, before we let you go, we also want to talk about diversification, as we may say that, debt funds also help us in diversifying the portfolio. You think risk mitigation is something that also has to be looked at, and obviously you touched upon the risk taking part of it, but anything you want to sum up before we close the session?
So Pallavi, like you rightly pointed out, when it comes to investing, and Sanjeev brought this point very clearly, that it's not whether you get 2% more, it's whether you are comfortable with what you have and what is the amount of portfolio returns you want to generate. That's very, very important that investors start accepting what is acceptable to them. So if your neighbor, we always have this ad which has neighbors and we owner's pride. So when you see someone making 100% in the market, you feel very sad, he's making 100%. But do you have the risk appetite for it? If you don't have the risk appetite for him, let him enjoy his returns, you be happy with yours. And that's where most important element is to do proper diversification, proper asset allocation, but not see historical returns. So only thing I want to see, time and again, we've seen history never repeats. And you have to learn from history. So if markets have given you 50%, 100%, don't think that will repeat. And because some asset class has outperformed the other, it doesn't mean that asset class will always outperform. Look at history, look at the future perspective, take help of advisors, create long-term asset allocation. And I think so, we started that call, discussion on discipline. If the investor remains disciplined with the help of the advisor, remains focused on the goal, invest systematically, I think so their investment journey will be far superior to someone else.
Great. Great thoughts. And on that note, I would like to take the closing comments from Sanjeev sir. As we can understand from this whole discussion that there is no one size fits all formula when it comes to financial planning. But still, if you think, are there any specific type of investors for whom debt could be perfect? I mean, what's your answer on that?
Debt is perfect for everybody.
Okay.
There is no doubt in it. How much depends entirely on three things, basically. Number one, we have already said, is risk profile. That is uppermost. There is nothing which will come before risk profile. Number two is goals. When are the goals coming up? So if you have goals which are coming up in very short period, definitely one has to go in for safer alternatives like debt funds and not venture into equity at all.
Okay.
That is a second. Third is, of course, market conditions. Conditions dictate that when can you have slightly higher equity or lower debt or higher debt. For example, right now when markets are at all-time highs, nobody knows whether they are going to higher valuations or not, though all indications are. Still, for people who are jumpy, I would use this word, for people who are very uncomfortable with losing even 1 rupee of their hard-earned money, so-called hard-earned money, they should be now moving to debt from equity.
Okay.
And also remember that they should not have a FOMO, fear of missing out. Markets can go anywhere. But if you made your money safe, then don't look back. What have I left? Look at what you gave.
Correct, correct. Great thoughts. I think it was a very great indeed, very insightful session. Wonderful to have both of you on the panel. And thanks everyone for being part of this session. We'll bring some more sessions in association with Mirai. Thank you, both of you.
Thank you very much, Pallavi and Vaibhav.
Thank you, Sanjeev sir.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.